Hi, everybody. My presentation is called Jesus Hair and Holiday Cheer. It's not quite as profound as the Century of the Sensory, but you'll forgive me as we go. It's quite a broad topic, this, when I thought about what can be influential ideas. And so I've got quite a broad response that rambles a little bit, so you can forgive me again for that as well. But my way around that is to say that what I've tried to do is make this a practical presentation on a year of really trying to create ideas that influence people. And this year, more than any other year over the last 5 years since I spoke to the APG last, what I think planning does and how what I look for in ideas that influence things has changed more than it has before. So towards the end, I'll get to some examples of work we've been doing this year on Stella and just talk about how I think we've been doing different things to try and influence that work. Yes, here we go. I said practical, and then the first slide I put up says like the most impractical idea, big influential ideas that I've seen in the last decade. Obama, hope, and the Occupy things. When you think of influential ideas, you often think of the ones that, you know, fill up your Facebook stream or light a fire or change, get people marching out on the streets. But I guess my point today is that we can learn from all of these kinds of ideas. But we shouldn't beat ourselves up that if our latest FMCG brief doesn't have people marching on the streets, that it's a problem. But I'm going to try and take some of the learnings from them and approach them to some very practical problems, like how do we raise awareness of an event sponsorship? And you know, it works. So I started with my planner trick number one to try and find an answer for this presentation. I Googled it. I didn't find the answer. There's a lot of words here. There's things that are influential, people listening, all these kind of things. And so the answer wasn't there. So I went to plan trick number two. I sent an all-staff email and asked people to talk about, to send me some examples of influential ideas that they'd seen this year. I'm disappointed if people have only seen them this year, but one guy referenced toilet paper, and somebody else said Marxism. Influential ideas, yes. But not useful for this presentation. So some of the ones that came up, and you'll have seen all these, so I'm not gonna go through what these ideas were, but what I'm gonna go through, I'm gonna run through some of the things that, the influential ideas I've seen in the past 12 months that, and rather than explain what they are, take some of the things that I've taken out of what these ideas are doing that's different than what maybe we've been trained to look at in advertising ideas. The no makeup selfie, filled our Facebook streams and raised over £8 million in 6 days or something like that. But what I liked about this idea was it wasn't a very smart end line. It pretty much does what it says on the tin, right? It's just four words. It's kind of it. That's it. I don't need to explain anything else about the campaign to you. The Ice Bucket Challenge, Homer Simpson doing it. Yes, again, filled our Facebook streams. But what I liked about this one is I'd never heard of ALS. Obviously, most of us hadn't, I'm sure. And there's no way anybody is leaving this year without having heard about it. But compared to the rest of our briefs that we all answer all of the time, I'm very sure that it wasn't a brief to raise awareness. They approached the brief to how can they engage people in this problem and get them to do something. Like a Girl, I don't know if you've seen this, finally one for a brand came up. It's from Always, the Like a Girl campaign. And it's a really powerful thing. That video has like nearly 100 million hits probably, but the whole thing of asking at what point does it become a bad thing for something to be done like a girl. It's a really powerful piece. And again, it's not your traditional advertising kind of summation of an idea, is it? Yes, exactly. Climate name change. Again, it's not the catchiest end line, is it? This campaign that was done by an agency in New York to try and rename hurricanes after people that aren't so nice, like Sandy, but after people that deny climate change exists. And they got 108,000 people to sign a petition, but again, they did it in a funny way as well. I think that not everything has to be, not influential ideas, they don't all have to be so big and powerful and emotional, they can be funny. I Break the Internet, obviously we all, and Jesus Hair from my title. So again, silly ideas can be influential as well. But the point on these, there's a few points that have kind of helped me think about what I think influential ideas are. Influential ideas, they make you feel, I wrote on the slide, they make you feel different and they make you do something, but my more eloquent longhand that I wrote afterwards, I said they make you feel compelled to do something, whether that's click on a button, take a like button, take a picture, make a donation, go and march out on the street. Influential ideas move us emotionally and physically. They move us emotionally, and then they encourage us to do something. And you'll notice I went through all of those ideas that I think have been influential ideas this year, and I took just the phrases, but actually all of those phrases are hashtags. And I thought that was interesting that all of the campaigns that are liked and references influential things that have happened have been hashtags. And I am, don't worry, I'm one of the planners that has despaired over the last 12 months as I've had to sit on a conference call and argue that we shouldn't have a hashtag on our retail press ad. But actually what it made me think a bit about was what hashtags mean, because we've been arguing over the last 5 years with everybody that we need to make brands that do things rather than just say things. I think actually the notion of a hashtag is more of a verb. It's more of an active thing that encourages you to think of something as a platform for conversation and a platform for things to start rather than a way of summing things up. And that is one of the provocative things I would say, that influential ideas are ideas that provoke and start something. Whereas I think we've been trained to look for ad ideas, and this is a bad word that can be insulting to some people, ad ideas that pacify. When I say pacify, all creative directors will kill me, but I think the ideas that I went through, they're actually statements of intent. They are something that there is to set a ball rolling and kind of a platform that others can then start building upon. Whereas in the ad industry, I think we've been looking for things to tie a knot underneath a story. It's like you kind of finish your press ad and you get to the end and you wait for a round of applause from everybody. You kind of draw that thread through everything. I think I was definitely trained to look for that, something that draws a thread through everything and ends it there. So therefore, you end up with, just for example, Like a Girl is a great provocation that gets people talking about things. But actually the end line that was sold says rewrite the rules or something like that. Some generic marketing thing that I'm sure makes a lot of sense of all the things that brief needed to do. And you get, and you'll see that in a lot of the campaigns, even in the stuff that I will share later, because we haven't found a perfect answer. The provocative piece that is running through the center, the idea, the influential idea, is often like the big piece in the center, and there's an end line hidden underneath it somewhere that nobody really cares about, but it's actually there to tie all of these things together. One thing we've been saying as a soundbite of things, it's a bit cheesy, but the traditional ad idea, because this has kind of become something that we've accidentally tried to start doing a lot more of. We had this old line, is that the best sign of an idea is if you can execute it in a poster. But actually, I think an influential idea is if you can imagine somebody writing a post about it. So some of these things are hard to just execute in a pure print execution, but I can completely imagine somebody writing about them after they see them. And so I've said the bit, I've given out about how we've been trained to look for creative ideas. Actually, the bit that maybe we can make the bigger difference on is the model that we look at successful, or that we try and put our advertising in. And this is about how we brief things. I think even though we've all moved, and everybody attends conferences all of the time, and hears about how marketing's changing and how we need to do all of these new buzzwords, be 24/7 content live, all of these things. But the marketing briefs we get are often very built in something we heard when we were probably 13 years old, AIDA, awareness, interest, desire, action. There's still, even no matter how much we change the type of outputs we want from them, big integrated campaigns, we're still looking for those things in our objectives a lot. So what we've been trying to do a little bit more of is take those briefs and try and put them through a lens that asks for a campaign that generates emotional response, builds momentum, and then has an action attached to it. And there's lots of elements to each of these. What kind of emotional response you want from something is a very hard question to ask yourself in a brief, because you end up very quickly running out of times you can say happy. Believe me. But you know, you have to get much more specific about what it is you're trying to drive. And then what we've been really, you know, probably bad at over the years is the momentum piece. And often in campaigns that we've all loved, the momentum has happened by accident because we've created something so emotional that that everybody has, you know, talked about this naturally and it's caught fire out in the world. But now there's all of these mechanics out in the world and platforms where we can create that momentum ourselves. So asking ourselves in the briefs, well, okay, we're going to generate this emotional response, then what are we going to do to feed that fire? How are we going to keep pushing momentum into this? And that's, I likened it swinging and just hitting a ball without following through. We haven't been very good at following through and creating the momentum in our campaigns. And action is one of the hardest bits because it's often just is by this. But how can we think of interesting, smart actions that help this momentum turn into something tangible? Is something that we're trying a lot on the briefs we're working on. I think what I go into then, having promised to be practical about the type of briefs I talk about, the first reference point I have from others is how we rebranded feminism, which I'm sure you're all sitting on your desk, the same brief. And this one is, it was with Elle magazine, and they asked us about feminism, and I asked the planner, because it turned into, from one press ad, it turned into quite a big thing, a lot of momentum built around it, and there was a lot of actionable things that people could do from it. And I asked the planner earlier on to refresh me on why they got to where they got to with it, and he said because when they were talking about feminism, that pretty much meant that anything that affected 50% of the people in the world could be the topic. So they tried to get in, when they wanted to get it to a more emotional place, they asked how could they make the topic of feminism more relevant and personal to more people. So they went to the area of pay and the pay gap based on a fact they found that 20% of women earned less than their male counterparts in jobs that was just sitting on the National Statistics website. And then instead of a press ad to try and win creative awards, the ad just says this: if he does the same job as you, ask him his salary. The ad just encourages an action and took people to a website where they could, based on all of these national statistics facts we have, see what the projection was of what they earned versus what their male colleague would earn. And following this, it got then the momentum building from this, even though we hadn't necessarily planned it in, we had to react quickly to it. We held debates with prominent feminists and politicians about the pay gap, and ended up, one of our planners ended up on BBC News talking about the topic, and it was debated in Parliament. So an example, again, this is one of our learning pieces on how we started to kind of, how can we make this an emotional piece, but give a very actionable thing, ask somebody his salary, a very actionable thing to ask people to go and do, and fuel that fire with lots of other things to keep building the momentum. The next one I have is one, I'm hoping this works. So. This case study, again, this is a more practical one of, it's very easy to talk about how we build emotion and momentum, and it's everybody, I'm sure, will agree, but then you end up with a brief on your desk, and for a brand that is, the most influential thing about this brand has probably been what people negatively have said about it for lots of years, so we're constantly trying to do more positive influence to build that back, to build back its premium heritage. And also, it's a very basic brief. It's our first year sponsoring Wimbledon. How do we raise awareness? How do we build awareness of this? And during the development of this, we did the classic planning things. We found the three boxes of the brand insight is we care about the details. These events all care about the details as well. And our consumers want more crafted beers. So excellent, perfect. It's all adding up together, and it's perfection is in the details. And that was perfect for when we were just making a TV ad. And we tried to start making it bigger and tried to start making it a big kind of journalistic content piece that we didn't really understand at the time until we started with that core idea, and it was really boring. This was a lot of very boring stories about details. So it made us go back to some of the things that we'd learned. Actually, we ourselves tried to turn this into a hashtag and a more actionable thing, and just made it a thing about celebrating perfectionism. And the campaign call to action in the center became Here's to Perfection. And we created maybe 100 different pieces of content that were all kind of about surprising stories of perfection. I'll just play this case study video because what has happened here is, as a result, the trade, it's had a massive influence on the trade, it's had a massive influence on consumers, and it had a massive influence on how we worked as a team to put this kind of campaign together as well. previously, and I've done these videos for APG awards and stuff, and honestly, we've been making up the momentum that we built through. We've kind of gone, oh, this happened by accident, this happened by accident. But this one, because of the approach we took through this and trying to have a more active idea at the core of this, the momentum was all built in and planned, so it was ready to go once things started kicking off. We had lots of all of the other kind of fire starters ready to go throughout the campaign. And also, you know, you all probably work on gigantic agency teams and big clients. When you have an idea that is influential and not just summing up an ad campaign, it's really easy for the other agency teams to get involved and just start building on it. It's a platform for them to go and build on things. So that's one. The biggest change we did as a team on this, and I think it plays to, you know, a lot of the culture points that that we've just heard as well from Tracy, it made me question whether actually we should be called planners or editors throughout this process, because having gotten to that initial place that strategy always gets to of this platform, then the role became a very active, how do we bring this to life? How do we sent researchers out, a research team to go and find stories for us. The planners built a kind of structure for how those stories needed to fit in on things. The creative reviews became more like newsroom meetings. Literally, we called them newsroom meetings, where everybody was talking about the different stories coming in. We had 50 stories, we're narrowing them down to 10. So the whole process was far more editorial than what we would traditionally have as planners. And this is something we've taken on to the next project that have been working on all year. And on this one, again, the biggest difference on these is 2 years ago, these campaigns would have just been quite advertising ideas, and this year they're not. They're just trying to be something else. Stella Artois, again, this is more of a US-led campaign where it's a very different brand, and competing against craft beers, there's a real demand for it to feel more authentic. And nobody knows where it's from or that it has a story. So this is, but again, by saying the emotional question, instead of just raising awareness of us being born at Christmas, by raising this emotional question, we were able to ask why should people care and how can we add a bit more depth to that story. So this campaign is launching tomorrow.
Back in 2007,
but you'll get it.
And I was living in Michigan. We met in September. I quit my job, sold my house, and by New Year's Day, we were here in Portland to start our lives together. There was no way that we couldn't jump headfirst. I remember when we came out here, it was kind of a rainy day, and seeing that beautiful oak tree and just feeling like this was home. The oak tree is like the centerpiece of our farm. You can't miss it. This is where we planted our roots. We're gonna raise our family. We're going to get old here. Jeff has been talking about lighting this oak tree up. That is something that Jeff has dreamt about for years. And it's always come to the conclusion that it's more of a lofty dream than something that could really be a reality.
Hey, how's it going?
Good.
This is just gonna look magnificent.
It's not something that he would ever do for himself.
What's going on?
Keep your head still. Just come this way.
When I'm around him, I feel safe. He makes me feel valued and loved. It's a way to give him that wow that I get on a daily basis from just being with him.
Okay, I'm gonna take your blindfold off.
Oh my God. Wow. It's incredible.
Can you believe it?
I think that's the craziest thing I've ever seen.
I know.
What's so cool about all these lights and this gift for him is more about what that gift can do for other people.
Hey! I don't really have words for it because it's just, it's beautiful.
meant to play it another way around, where we do the launch piece, which tells you we're giving away our whole ad as a gift for Christmas, but you probably got that as we went through it. But it's, it was two years ago, so we made this ad 2 years ago where we said we were born at Christmas and it was just an ad. And this has been a big effort to try and actually make that mean something a bit more and to create momentum around that story and build more things. So everything in the ad has been given away and there's stories for each of them, and we basically stole everybody from Vice to come and help make it. But it's the same approach where the planners have been far more editorial, far more involved in this user journey piece, which is why I completely agree about UX planners and brand planners working together in some kind of hybrid, which becomes far more culture focused. And so, yeah, there's about 10 of them, but yeah, I'm not going to play the original. I'm going to try and skip through this one if I can, because this was the original launch piece. And that comes from, again, just that observation of the kind of ideas we want to do being not things that we want to sum up in a poster, but things that we want to be a statement of intent that start something much, much more. I think those are the ideas that have influence. And as planners, we're trying to ask in our briefs, why should people care? How can we add fuel to this fire? And what do we want to ask people to do with that? And that's what we're doing. Thank you.